Thank you all for coming. My, there's a lot of you. Really appreciate it. My name's Vance Burberry. I'm a cinematographer and I have been for about 35 years. I also love scuba diving, which I've been doing for nearly 40 years. I'm an instructor trainer for the National Association of Underwater Instructors in the United States, and I've been so for 25 years. Underwater cinematography is a huge amount of fun. You get to go to really great places like the Caribbean and in Mexico and the Sea of Cortez and all these amazing places. You also get to go underwater in swamps, tanks, swimming pools and all sorts of ugly places as well. But it's a lot of fun, and but there's quite a bit more to it than, you know, working on land. I work on land a lot, that's about 90% of my work, but the other 10% is underwater. I've been teaching this class for many years. It's a lot of fun, and I think you're gonna find it very interesting, because when you go underwater, especially optically, everything changes. When you're underwater, everything changes. It's a very challenging. Communication changes, the elements of safety change. You're put into a lot of different environments. We're dealing with scuba equipment. We're dealing with safety. We're dealing with talent in the water. We're dealing with a lot of electricity around the tanks. So it can be pretty dangerous and a lot of fun at the same time. For example, this is a tank in Acton, California. It's built purely for scuba. I'm sorry, purely for shooting in. It's 16 feet deep, and as you can see, they have a camera platform sticking out behind me there. That's me, and I'm tethered to the surface via a cable for WCU4 for the ARRI. Alexa Mini. A little bit more. I'm just going to show you some pictures just to give you a sense of working in the water generally. And here's sort of an overall look at the potential things you can do shooting underwater work. Thank you. Okay, so as you can see, we work in many different environments. Some of the work is in the ocean, some is in tanks, and some is in regular swimming pools. First, let's talk about the ocean. This is a frame from a music video which I just shot the underwater on for Bad Bunny. Shot on 35 millimeter film. We're about 30 feet down by an island off the coast of Los Angeles called Catalina Island. The support for something like this is quite major. You're gonna need surface support, you have a marine coordinator, you have safety divers, you have various camera boats, you've got to have air supplies. It gets very, very involved. This is our camera boat that we used. As you can see, it's a big open platform. Believe it or not, this thing will do about 50 kilometers an hour. And we can load cranes on here, you can load dive equipment on here, you can have your safety team on here. There's a million things you can do with this in the ocean, but you really need a platform like this to work on, or multiple versions of this. As well as this, we had a large dive boat, a lot of scuba tanks, and also compressors for air fills. We also did surface work. As you can see, this is a 35 millimeter Hydroflex camera housing with a ARRI 435 inside. What we're laying on here is a rescue board, and we were doing some surface work. You know, this housing is around 95 pounds out of the water, so holding this up on the surface is almost impossible. Well, is impossible. So we lay on a platform like so that we can keep the camera on the surface, so we can have jet skis blow by us at 40 knots and knock us out of the water. The guy behind me here is a gentleman by the name of Matt O'Connor. Excuse me, I'm a little nervous, just starting out. A gentleman by the name of Matt O'Connor. Matt is a Marine coordinator. He's world renowned. He did the movie 13, which is about the Thai cave divers, or the cave divers in Thailand rescuing the kids trapped in the cave. He also did the new Avatar film. I can trust this man with my life, and in many cases, you are trusting them with your life. You know, I've got jet skis coming at me at full speed, going either side of me. He's got his hand on my back the whole time. He'll grab me and pull me off there really quickly if he sees anything that can be a potential danger. With ocean work, you really need this kind of person with you. If you're not Matt O'Connor, there's a lot of guys in the world that do this, but it's really, really important to have people in charge on the surface with safety. Production will always try and rush you with things like this, good, fast, cheap, you know, pick two, but they want it to be fast. And unfortunately, working in the water is not fast, so you've got to just slow things down, keep things under control, do nothing that is unsafe. People will die in the water very, very quickly. It's a very, very dangerous environment. So especially in the ocean, which is sort of, you really have no control over ocean conditions with currents, surface conditions, visibility, and things like that, you really need to have a great team with you to make sure that you're safe. Now you move into a pool, which is a little different. This is the sort of thing we do in a pool. This was shot in that pool you just saw.
Because brains are so different than transistor circuits, we have to rethink everything we know about computer architecture. Traditional microprocessors are synchronous, meaning every function is governed by a clock. The clock says when instructions are executed and when functions happen. Everything works in unison, according to the clock. Our brains are different. They're asynchronous, meaning no internal clock. Neurons operate with no prescribed order. We just have thoughts. Thoughts that build on each other. Or split off into different ideas. That's the way neuromorphic computing works too. It's completely asynchronous. So functions and instructions happen when they happen, in parallel. Which means neuromorphic systems think more like brains do. They can adapt, recognize nuances, and teach themselves as they work. It's an elegant, organic, and beautiful way to think.
Okay, so different environment, okay? A lot more controlled, a lot safer. Those ladies in the water are a group of ladies known as the Aqualilies. They are they're a synchronized swim team. They do projects all over the world. They have a European division. They're in the United States. These girls, they swim much better than any of us. So you feel very comfortable working with these girls in the water, but at the same time, we still always have safety divers in the water for the pure reason that if anybody gets hurt or gets caught underwater, sometimes you're gonna have set pieces under the water that you can get trapped in. So you've always gotta have safety divers in the water at all times. Here I am actually working on the surface work with these guys with a float. That's a Hydroflex Mark V housing. And you can see here, this is, for those of you that are divers, this is a buoyancy compensator with a quick release plate on the top that we can just add air to so we can actually split surface. The only problem with that is it's very top heavy. So you're kind of hanging onto that camera really tight to stop it doing this because you're putting buoyancy up from underneath and it wants to flip over like that. So you have to hang on to that really tight, and that's the only time you hang on to an underwater housing really tightly. We're gonna talk about that in a little later on, but this is the only time you do it. When you're on the surface, you've gotta hang on to that thing for dear life, especially when the water's moving around a lot. Once you come underneath, now we're holding the camera like a Steadicam. Very gently. If you hang on to it like this, any movement through your body is put through the camera. So you kind of hold it like a Steadicam pose. Fingertips, even though it's heavy, it's now neutrally buoyant. So if I can let this housing go and it's just gonna sit there and float, it's gonna sit. So I can move that through my fingers. There is a lot of inertia because this is about 85 pounds or what's that in kilos? Say 40 kilos out of the water. It's neutrally balanced in here, but it's got so much mass, you've got a lot of inertia. So it does take a bit of energy to push it, but you still wanna be really, really gentle with it because you avoid this and this. Now, obviously we're not always hand-holding a camera. We have underwater tripods. I sit on a ladder a lot of the time. If I've got a shot, I've got a hold with someone, I'll just sit on a ladder. So don't feel that you always have to be hovering with the camera, but you will be doing that a lot of the time. One more video, and then then I'll do a little more talking. Hang on. This is actually a job I did with six 12K Blackmagic cameras, which were actually running 4K at 120 frames. This was for a motion capture or mocap for an Olympic swimmer named Caleb Dressel. All these cameras were actually fixed in fixed positions. We had to calculate distances and focal lengths so we could capture the swimmer from the sides, from below, and we also had three cameras above. With motion capture, he wore a motion capture suit, the nature of refraction in the water would not give you any accurate representation. So we had to actually just capture footage, and then they took that and then animated that on the backside. With Avatar, they had actually developed a motion capture camera that actually would do real motion capture, but we didn't have it available for this shoot, so. It's very new technology. Now each camera had to be set to a certain angle. We took measurements. We used measurements for everything. Everything is exactly the same tilt angle. Everything is the same distance. We're using the C-stand as reference. As you can see, there's the underwater shot from straight up. And that's coming from these cameras here. So they're pointing straight up. What's interesting, these cameras were, once they were rigged and set, they were sitting underwater for about 6 hours, powered up, never coming out of the housings, which is rare because normally you're going to pull the camera and you're going to reload, change batteries, but they were powered from the surface. When I took the cards out of the cameras at the end, literally I couldn't hold the CFast 2 cards in my hands. They were so hot. Guy with man with C-stand. Okay. So the other option, another option is shooting in an outdoor pool. We land up shooting this at night. This was a green screen job. We had 8,000 watt HMI underwater psych lights on the green screen. And we actually built a stage because it was for Garth Brooks. And he actually had his band performing underwater on scuba gear, dropping down into the shot. Of course, Garth didn't go underwater. We've shot him in front of a green screen in slow motion so that he appeared underwater and put a lot of bubbles in later, even though he's a scuba diver, so I don't understand why he wouldn't get in the water, but, you know, he didn't. As you can see, that's what it looks like underneath. I mean, I've got to say I was impressed with these guys. I don't know how many of you are scuba divers, but the whole band had literally just been trained right before this, and they were able to start at the surface, dump their buoyancy compensators, and all drop down without falling over, which was really impressive. But as you can see, I have five band members in, and you can see the number of people who are in the water around us. These are all safety divers. Every talent I have in the water, I've got one safety diver for that person. That's a really important thing to remember. As you know, there's of late, we've seen a lot of accidents happening on film sets that should never happen. And so when you're doing water work, every talent you've got in the water, one safety diver per person. So that's kind of a general thing with pools. Now we've got tanks. Sadly, you'd think in Los Angeles we'd have a massive amount of tanks. We do not. We have a very limited amount of tanks. This tank here is in Light Studios in Brussels. This is what we'd like to have. We don't have it. In Rosarito, Mexico, Baja Studios, they did build a facility when shooting the Titanic, which does have these kind of tanks. What's nice, if you look here, this is, you can build a set above water. Whole art department can build and lay a set in and then drop it into the water, submerge it. It's a big platform. I believe that one of these tank goes to 32 feet deep, and you can sink the platform down to whatever depth you need it to allow you to shoot underwater. This is another stage. I think you saw underwater at this stage with the girl swimming around the grandfather clock. This was actually the Bad Bunny video, which I had shown you as a submarine at the start. Construction crane, the whole set is built and framed. We have a stunt coordinator on set that supervises all that support. There's chain motors, there's overhead construction crane. This is going to be slowly dropped bit by bit into the water, so they've got to do that with chain motors. Once the construction crane lowered it to the surface, then there's a chain motor system that slowly lowers it into the water, and this room slowly floods, and it looks like this. Now, I'm here with, again, 35 millimeter film camera. The scary part of this was literally I have this much room between the side of the tank and the set piece, right? So my stunt coordinator, TJ White, who's fantastic, before anybody went even near this, he's double checking every point of rigging because it's really, really dangerous. You've got no room, there's nowhere to go if something breaks. So having a lot of safety checks and support is really, really important. And that's what the tank looks like with no one there. What's nice about this facility, when you come in tonight, he's got a whole truss system, which you can see it rolls backwards and forwards over the top. There's some M90s up here, I think, Arri M90s, and then a couple of M40s, I think. I can't quite remember, but anyway, this is kind of a little lower, and they can cover that with black, so you can shoot in the daytime and turn it into a nighttime situation. He can make it higher. He has underwater blacks, underwater greens to line this whole tank. This is in the middle of the desert, so you're not going to get bothered. You can shoot there all night. I've done a lot of it's not that big. It's 24 feet wide by 40 feet long. The deep end is 16 feet, which is a good amount of room. It's gray concrete inside. So I've shot stuff without any blacks or drapes on the back at all. And it still looks pretty nice. And also with the water, it disappears fairly quickly. Now, speaking of safety divers, I was doing a job. The back wall slopes down like so. My tank valve is on the right-hand side. Righty-tighty, it closes this way. I'm literally sliding down the wall, shooting up. What I didn't realize is the valve was being closed. So I'm like, I get down to the bottom 16 feet, and I'm like, no air. Quick safety diver, shoved a regulator in my mouth. I could have just bolted to the surface, but safety diver sitting right there, stuck a regulator in my mouth, I was fine. But something as silly as that, I mean, I've been doing it for years, didn't even think about it. So now every time I'm on a slope, I'm very aware of where my valve is. So you continually learn this by screwing up. And of course, you don't want to screw up like this in the ocean because it could kill you. So need to pay attention to that stuff. All right. That's sort of some very basics, and now I'm going to start talking about optics underwater. Everything changes. Flat ports. When you go and rent a housing from whether it be Hydroflex or you're going to go and buy an underwater housing, there's basically two kinds of ports. There's what we call a flat port and a dome port. Both create what is called a virtual image. Though a flat port creates a virtual image that's about 25% closer than the subject really is. Okay, so what happens? Light, let's talk about sunlight. sun goes from a vacuum at 186,000 miles per second. It hits our atmosphere, slows down, bends, why the stars twinkle, and atmosphere. Hits the surface of the water, bends again, refraction. Now, once we're underwater, here's the water, then now we're going to go through glass, more refraction, back through air, more refraction. So things are getting bounced around pretty good. Now, with a flat port, here is your subject. Contrary to popular belief, a flat port does produce a virtual image, which makes it appear closer to the lens. And you'll notice this, those of you that are scuba divers will know from your scuba diving class that underwater with your mask on, it's magnifying 25%. It's actually creating a virtual image, which means it's an image that's 25% closer. So if your infinity is 40 meters, for example, then your subject is actually going to appear as if it's at 30 meters, so about 25% closer. So you need to account for that if you're actually presetting focus marks. The other thing you can't do with this is use a wide lens. Nothing wider than 55 millimeters on a flat port. Why? Radial distortion. So what happens is, if you put a wide angle lens in a flat port, the only clean light that's going to come through that flat port is in the center. Everything else is going to bend and distort, and you're going to, number one, it's going to distort at the edges like so. And number two, only the center is going to be in focus. This is really crucial to remember. So 55 millimeters, you're only going to 55 millimeters or above if you're shooting macro work or you're really shooting a detailed close-up. Then you can use a longer lens. If you put a wide lens in this, this is what's going to happen. And why? The further you go out from the center, the more refraction there is. So in the center, the light's clean. You go off center, it refracts a little more. The further out you get, the more it refracts. So remember this. There is a thing that happens. People say, oh, well, put a wide lens in there. If you're going to shoot a split surface shot, use a flat port. The reason being is because when you use a dome port, your virtual image is way closer. So if you want to hold focus on the top and under the surface, it can be a little bit of a problem. But don't forget, your person on the surface is going to look one size. You look under, they're going to gain about 100 kilos and look way bigger, which you don't want to do. So then we go to a dome port. Anything wide angle, which is very commonly used. You can shoot long lenses with this too, but primarily we focus on wide angle lenses. The reason here is wherever the light enters the dome, you're getting clean light. It's not going to distort. A dome port, it doesn't no matter where an object is, light from that object can go through the dome port unrefracted, and this is not possible with a flat port. But here's where the big difference is. Your virtual image on a dome port is pretty much sits right in front of the glass. So, for example, you have an 8-inch dome port. You have an 8-inch dome port with a radius of 4 inches. Infinity is now at 16 inches, 4 times the radius of that port. So when you're picking a lens, you're going to need to have a lens that will focus 16 inches, and you're probably need to focus as close as 10 or 11 inches, depending on how close you've got to bring that subject. If not, you've got to drop in diopters. And if you're going to drop in diopters, you need to shoot a test. Yes, there is math for a diopter, but really to be accurate, you need to shoot a test. So when you're thinking about this, always think about close focus of the lens you're using, if possible. Here's what happens. The greater the angle from the object, the more refraction there is. That means we want to shoot the entrance pupil or your iris, we want to stop down. I like to shoot 5, 6, 8 whenever possible. Can we do that all the time? No. But just know that if you're shooting a wider aperture, the wider that aperture, you're going to start losing a bit of crispness around the outside edges. You know, a lot of the time this doesn't matter. You're going to hold a subject in the center of the frame. But certainly with a digital camera now, with these high ISO ratings, you should be able to at least shoot up around a 4, 5, 6. And we're just going to stay pretty clean around the edges. What's immediately obvious about the dome port's virtual image from this diagram is that no magnification occurs. So a 25 is going to look like a 25, an 18 is going to look like an 18. It's not going to be magnified, which is different to the flat port. The dome port makes things look closer, but it also shrinks them. This exactly cancels out the magnification effect so that everything appears the correct size. Cool, huh? This is just another reference. Here's your, online. It's a visualized link. I'm not online, so I can't really show you right now. But the object distance, the dome size, and the aperture size directly affect the distance of the subject in relation to infinity. The closer it comes, you get inside infinity, then you're going to be pulling focus back closer. Now, another thing related to dome ports is dome port position. Now, the position of the entrance pupil in relation to the dome port is critical. Certainly, if you're going to go and buy a Nauticam housing and maybe put a Sony A7 or a Blackmagic Pocket 6K, you go to the manufacturer and they actually have a port configuration for a specified lens. So the entrance pupil will be sitting in the correct position for that particular lens dome port combination from the manufacturer. Now, when you're in our professional world, when we're using Hydroflex housings or Alexa Mini housing, and we're putting a Alexa Mini in there, and we're putting, let's say, a 18 millimeter Cook S4, or we're putting another lens in there, we need to know where that entrance pupil is so we can position that entrance pupil in the correct position in relation to the dome. Now, how to find the entrance pupil? You think, oh, where's the iris? Where's the entrance pupil? It's the back of the lens, which in most cases is in the back of the lens. But as far as it's concerned with finding the entrance pupil for a dome port, we want to find the perceived position of the entrance pupil. Now, I have this lens. This is a still lens, but I use this reference because the photograph is pretty accurate. If you look here, you can see the iris, right? The iris appears to be about here, not at the back where it actually physically sits, but it appears to be right here. And this is especially happens with zoom lenses. Like a lot of the time, I'll use a 15 to 40 ingenue. Lens like zoom lenses will tend to show that that entrance pupil closer to the front of the lens. But whatever, you've got to look at the front of the lens, know where the entrance pupil, and you'll do this in camera prep, entrance pupil is. Now we know, I'd put a piece of tape right here on the dome, on the lens, so I have a reference point of where the entrance pupil sits. Now when you're prepping the camera, oops. Okay, I put this slide in backwards, but I'll do it right now. In a correct position, now you see the curvature of the dome. You imagine the dome is a sphere, all right? It's a ball. The entrance pupil sits in the center of the ball, not necessarily the center relation to the dome, because the dome is only a piece of that ball. So you've kind of got to imagine if you continue that dome around and you find the very center of that ball, that's the optical center of the dome. That's where we want the entrance pupil to sit. If it sits too close, light will get bent and will cause softness to the edges again. If you go too far back, same problem. So, as I just explained, the dome is a hemisphere, right? This is half the dome. All the light converges on this point here, which should be the iris, the center of the dome. In reality, the common dome porter, you're only going to see that much of it. So therefore, the entrance pupil, that white, that mark I put on the side of the lens, needs to sit right here. Because, again, it's the perceived position of the entrance pupil that you need to make this position to. This is crucial. So when you go into a camera house, you'll go camera house and prep your underwater housing, they'll have various extension rings so that you can get that entrance pupil to sit in the right position in relation to the dome. If I don't know if anybody saw Blue Planet 2, there's some footage of them shooting walruses on icebergs, and it's an above-over shot where they shoot underneath the water and on top. They custom built a 4-foot plexiglass dome. It's about this big. So what happened? Now we've got infinity. You can set focus to 8 feet for infinity. So they could put a wide lens. They can get close to the iceberg. They can see the walrus above, sharp as a tack. They can see the walrus underneath, sharp as a tack. Because now we've got a dome that pushes everything further back so it stays sharp. Here's what happens. You've got that entrance pupil too far forward, you're losing light. You're going to lose a little exposure, and you're also going to be soft around the edges. These are very important principles for any underwater photography, cinematography. It always applies. The rules, the physics do not change. And understanding this is really, really important. To my point, there's the dome. So, you know, unfortunately, there's not a measuring stick. So basically what you've got to look at your dome port here, and you've got to imagine where that center line is, and that is where your entrance pupil sits. That makes sense. Okay. I hope that makes sense to everyone. It's a really important part of understanding optics for shooting underwater. Okay. Another quick note. We've all been outside in the cold, taken lenses inside. We have to acclimatize them. They build up moisture. You know, they'll be all fogged up. Same thing will happen with a dome port or a flat port for that matter. You know, change of surface, above the surface, depending on water temperatures. You've got a hot camera inside. They can fog up inside. There's nothing worse than you drop into the pool, You roll 2 minutes later, or pool or tank, 2 minutes later, it's fogged up. Sorry, Mr. Director, I've got to come up, I've got to open up the housing, I've got to dry out the dome, and I'm going to go back again. They won't like you very much, you'll get yelled at. It happened to me a long time ago. So what we use is a desiccant. You can buy on this stuff on Amazon, it's little beads of silica. You can buy these on Amazon. I think a 2 pound container like this costs like $18 American dollars. Very cheap. And what's great about this stuff, as it becomes saturated with moisture, they turn green. You take them out, take them home, put them in the microwave for 3 minutes, and now they're orange again. You can use them again. I've had this container for like 5 or 6 years, and I'm still half full. What I do with a big cinema camera, I go to the cooking store, and I buy these cheesecloth bags for putting herbs in. They have a little string on them. I fill them up, I tie a knot in it, and then I'll strap it inside the camera or inside the housing. Be careful, don't put it anywhere. You're going to interfere with the focusing system, iris, any of that stuff. So I'll just find somewhere to tie it off. I try and get it closer to the dome if I can, because that's where the moisture is going to build up. But obviously, you've just got to find that happy balance of the two. These other things with these smaller housings, like, there's a lot of jobs out there now where I'll go and do a job, and we've got a couple of shots of girl jumps in pool, drunk guy falls in pool, whatever it may be. So drunk guy falls in pool, that's a common one. So, you know, I own a Nauticam housing with a Blackmagic 6K camera in there, I have a 14 to 24 Sigma zoom in there, art lens, and it's great. A lot of the time on a job like that where you got a couple of shots, they don't want to spend another, you know, okay, we need another Alexa body, we need an underwater AC, we need an underwater housing, and now you're spending $6,000 more to get two shots. You know, owning a little camera like that with something like the Blackmagic 6K, which, you know, I can match to cinema cameras really easily in the grade, are great for doing stuff like that. It shoots 50 frames a second at 6K RAW, but the same problem occurs. So now I just go and buy these little silica packs that, like, you see in electronics, and then I'll just tape one of those inside. I haven't got the room for the big bag, so I'll just tape that inside, somewhere inside. So then I'll use these little B packs. Again, they're really cheap. What are they? They're 5 grams, 5 gram packs. So, and they're 50, I get 50 for like $12 or something like that. So that's really important to understand with ports. Okay. Moving on from ports. Lighting, natural versus artificial. So, because when we're on land, what do we love? We love seeing that the sun is low and there's rays of glory and we think it's all beautiful and everybody looks amazing. And we love all that stuff, right? If you're in the ocean outside, that really sucks. That is the worst. It's completely opposite. It's completely opposite to being on land. What happens when that sun gets low? And either sunrise or sunset in the ocean, turns everything is like back like smoke, right? So basically it just becomes a big fog. What you want is top light. Top light works best for underwater. Even in a backlit situation, you've got the sun alone, you use the backlit. You know, in the ocean especially, it's full of particulate, it's full of, you know, plankton, and there's salts and all sorts of stuff in the water. So it just backlights it, turns it into a big fog. Certainly you can use a backlight in a pool more, but not in the ocean. So we want to use top light. So when I say, okay, we need to shoot this between 9 in the morning, in the summer, we need to shoot this from 9:30 in the morning till 4 in the afternoon. After that, we're done. And the AD says, no, we need to shoot till 6. That's, you know, but, you know, that's what they do. And then you go in at 5 o'clock, and you line up the shot, and the director's going, what's wrong? It's all like a big mess. I told you to shoot between then and then. So, you know, you got to do that. Tell people the window you've got to shoot in, otherwise it will bite you later. The more choppy it is, the more the light gets scattered. You've got a nice flat surface, more light rays penetrate, but they also scatter. Water scatters light, so that light disappears really fast. If it's overcast, it gets kind of gloomy under there. So sunlight is your friend in open water. Color loss. Those of you who are scuba divers, you'll be familiar with this. What do we lose at pretty much as soon as you get under the surface, you start losing color. So red is the first to go. The deeper you go, the more color you lose. With when we were using film cameras, we used to compensate that by adding a red filter, which is not really red. We called it a magic filter. It's sort of a salmon-colored filter or a magenta filter. We'd use magenta filters in colder water, where the water's more green, has a lot more plankton and so forth in it. In tropical waters, it's just very, very blue. We tend to use the more salmon-colored filter to offset that loss. Nowadays, if we shoot raw, we can go back and deal with that under on the back end. Certainly in with, say, a Blackmagic RAW file. If I go into the RAW file, I'm gonna add, in cold water, I'm gonna add probably plus 120, plus 130 magenta to get things neutral. So, Red is always the big issue, and magenta will help you big time. You can shoot a grayscale underneath the water. I sometimes will carry an 18% gray chip, so I can shoot a grayscale underwater. I don't worry about balancing underwater to that. I just use it as a reference point for white balance on the post side. Now, just a little bit more about water. Now, if we're in a pool, now we're going to get crinkle patterns. I call them crinkle patterns. I know there's some fancy name for them, which I always forget, so I just call them crinkle patterns. You know, when you see in the swimming pool, you see the crinkled light over people. Sometimes you want that, sometimes you don't. This is where a backlight can come into play really nicely. You can put a backlight in. You get all these nice little moving shafts. In a pool, which hasn't got as much particulate, you're actually able to put a somewhat of a backlight in there. I like to use like a 10K Xenon or maybe an REM 90, something like that. And you get this nice little backlit shaft. You saw that in one of the girls in the red bathing suits, that was a 18K RMX backlight. See, and it was flipped upside down, but that's the effect you get. Now, sometimes you don't want that. So what are you gonna do? You're in a pool outside. Now I'd put a big rag over the top, like full grid, half grid, something like that, big rag over the top. So you avoid the harsh sunlight. Now you've got this nice, soft, white top light. Or if it's nighttime, I'll hang, you know, S360s over the top, something like that. Big soft lights, you don't get all those crinkle patterns over the skin and over the face, and certainly things like green screens, you've got to avoid that because you can't have crinkle patterns over green screens. Big soft sources over top. Obviously, hard backlight's always really nice underwater to separate. There's a lot of equipment available for lighting. This is all Hydroflex equipment. I'm very fortunate. I live about 10 minutes from Hydroflex in LA with Pete Romano, and I can run over there and go and fiddle with the lights and see what we could have. This is a 1x1 light panel. They also, this is a 1x1 light panel rigged for underwater. This unit here can be either made 2500 HMI PAR or 4K HMI PAR. This is your basic underwater KinoFlow panel. And then this unit will come in either a 1.2K HMI PAR, 1200 watt tungsten, or 1K tungsten light. They also make a 5K version of this tungsten light. This here is a 8K HMI cyclite, which I was actually I used four of these for lighting that green screen in that in the video you saw. They also make this in a 10K tungsten unit as well. So you have a 10K tungsten and an 8K HMI. This is a SkyPanel S360. Again, you saw in the video of Caleb Dressel with the 12K Blackmagic cameras. These were laying on the bottom and up lighting from underneath. This here is a very important piece of equipment with lighting. What do electricity and water do not mix? I mean, you know, you want to fry everyone. Just plug in, put some electricity into some water. These units here are like a GFI. It's called a ground fault interrupter. They make the Hydroflex make these units in 40 amp and 100 amp, which that's in 110 volt in 220, that amperage is reduced by half. Now, they also make these you can also get a 400 amp distribution panel, three phase distribution that also has shock block or a global, ground port interrupter on it. When you walk onto a set and you're gonna work around water, as DPs, I get with my gaffer and I go, okay, show me every cable run and I want to see the GFI in line. This is so important. Don't take anybody's word for it. As the underwater cinematographer, I'm an underwater professional, I consider myself responsible for safety of people in set, especially regarding electricity. So, have your gaffer and go and walk every line, check every GFI, every single one. It's just not worth it. One cable like this that's not on a GFI and it drops in the water, you can kill someone. How many of you are divers? Oh, there's a lot of you, okay. Dive skills. Dive skills are crucial. Now, the wonderful thing about diving, what I always find about diving, is the fact that now we're actually all human drones. We're moving through 3D space. We can come down, we can go up. You're in the ocean, you can fly through canyons. It's really an amazing experience. To allow us to do that, we have to find neutral buoyancy. Neutral buoyancy is a state where I can just sit in the water and as I inhale, I rise up a little bit. As I exhale, I sink a little bit. This is as you descend under the water, if you're wearing exposure suit or a wetsuit or even just your body, as you descend, the water pressure around you reduces your volume, so you become more negatively buoyant and you start sinking. And the deeper you go, the faster you start to sink. You offset that with a piece of equipment called a buoyancy compensator. It's like a swim bladder in a fish. You're adding air to it. It increases your volume to find neutral buoyancy. To be precise with this takes a lot of practice and a lot of skill. And it is crucial to shooting underwater if you're not sitting on a ladder or you're not sitting on a tripod. If you're hovering in the water like you see me doing in here, that becomes critical. Because once you've got that camera in your hands, you've got a director and he's going to tell you to hold the shot. If you're sinking, you're going up, and there's an underwater speaker sitting on the side going, "What the hell are you doing? Hold the shot, hold the shot." Buoyancy control. Those of you who haven't gotten certified and want to do this, go get trained and practice your buoyancy control. First of all, without a camera, because you'll find once you'll think, "Oh, my buoyancy is insanely good. I'm so great at buoyancy." And then you put a camera in your hands. I teach a class in Los Angeles for professional underwater cinematographers that includes pool training. I actually did one last weekend before I came out here. And I had divers that, you know, there's an organization called GUE, which is Global Underwater Explorers. And honestly, they're amazing divers. And their dive skills are at a very high level. I put them in the pool with a 4-foot square frame of PVC piping that just sits there floating. And I say, "Okay, hover in there and don't hit the sides." None of them did it. It takes time and practice, and you just teach them technique and people get it, but it just takes a lot of practice. I know that some agencies, including mine, Patty, I know you have different agencies over here in Europe also, teach peak buoyancy control. It's something you should do if you want to shoot underwater. The other thing you do is, and this is kind of an apt thing, seeing we're at Cameron Marge talking about frogs. The normal flutter kick is that you see when you see the pretty girl in a pink wetsuit swimming along in the ocean, the commercials for, you know, diving in the Caribbean, they're all doing this. Problem with that is when you're swimming along, this happens. Happy-doo, doo-doo-doo, like that. So what we have is what is called a frog kick, and you literally are using both fins, and you're bringing back and you're kicking out like a frog, and you're kind of slapping your feet together. We call it a frog kick, hence perfectly fitting for this this festival. Frog kick, okay? So what does that do? Now we're moving evenly through the water, and now this reduces the camera roll. The second thing that you can also do, we can do a reverse frog kick, but only with a particular type of fin called a jet fin from a company called Scuba Pro. They got a very wide edge on the side of the fin. They're the same fin the Navy SEALs use, and you know, military dive teams use these fins. You can then do a reverse frog kick and pull back, which can be very simple. See, I hit my head. You can do a reverse frog kick and move backwards. So when you're feeling yourself drifting in on that close up, swim backwards and just pull it back a little bit. You can use a reverse frog kick. It's a really, really important thing to understand the buoyancy and the frog kick. Those are two things you really need to do. The other thing you can do, I can do a 4-foot boom camera move just using my breath. So I'm neutrally buoyant. When I'm neutrally buoyant, I'm somewhat in the middle of my breath. So I inhale, I exhale. Now I can go like, I can now have a camera in my hands and go and stop. Stop. You can actually use your breath to make a boom shot. 3 to 4 foot boom shot really easily by using your breath. And you can control, it's almost like on a boom on a dolly, you can feather the top and the bottom of the move with your breath, which is, it's actually really fun. I love doing it because it's kind of like showing off, it's great. Okay, this leads to the next thing we're talking about is camera operation. Now, even as I said, they hide reflex, deep water, film housing that has the ARRI 435 in it. That's 95 pounds out of the water. Hydroflex Mark, 95 pounds, so okay, around 40 kilos. The Hydroflex Mark V with an Alexa XT in it's about 35 kilos out of the water. Okay, so, but when you put it under the water and we've trimmed it, which we're gonna talk about a little later, it'll sit neutrally in the water. Like your Steadicam posts, which when you're on the Steadicam, you're not hanging on for it to dear life, you're hanging onto it with your fingertips because you're not putting any of this energy from your body through the post of the Steadicam. The same thing you need to do underwater with the big housing. Now, the big housing, you cut your little slack because there's so much inertia, it's really heavy. So you can hold it a little tighter. I still hold it with my fingertips. I still want to be able to just push it through the water, literally with my fingertips, because that gives you the most control. But you can get away with holding it a little tighter just because of the mass and the mass of the housing itself. It will absorb some of that movement. Now, I know a lot of guys are shooting with Sony A7Ss, Blackmagic 4K, Blackmagic 6K, Canon R5Cs, smaller housings, right? Even like the Nauticam Red Komodo housing is really small. So they're very light. It takes the slightest amount of energy from your body to make that camera do this and shake. You're never gonna get it flawless, but you can eliminate it a lot by the way you control your camera. Now, honestly, I think it's great practice to go out and shoot with a small housing before you use a big housing, because you're gonna get really used to managing the movement with a small housing. I own a little Steadicam Flyer, which is super lightweight, which I just use for little projects. That is really light. It's really, compared to a full-size rig, it's really light and really squirrely. So when I jump on a full-size Steadicam, it's pretty easy compared to, even though it's heavier, obviously, but it feels pretty easy compared to my little Steadicam that's really squirrely. But because I practice on the squirrely one, it's a lot easier on the big housing. Same for these, right? So that's something you'd look at. Okay, holding the shot. A lot of some of the work, obviously you've seen sort of land work. You've seen land work, but especially in the ocean when you're doing, I've done commercials for the Virgin Islands Tourist Bureau in the Caribbean, and I've shot stuff in Mexico with, you know, people swimming underwater or scuba divers, and animals. Sometimes they want you to shoot animals, especially if you're doing like Nat Geo stuff, they want looking at animals. So animals, much like actors, can't hit marks half the time. So you really want to hold shots. Now, any editor will tell you, editors will yell at you, you think you've held that shot long enough. So if you think you've held a shot on something long enough underwater, add 5 seconds. Editors will thank you for it. I mean, obviously this is the same thing you're doing on land, but for some reason I see people get underwater with a camera. I don't know whether it's because the pans are not as fast or the camera's not moving as fast because, you know, you're moving through water, but for whatever reason, people cut it short. Don't do that. Just hold it that few seconds longer. Your editor and director will thank you for it. Getting shots of animals takes time and patience. I did a job where I had to shoot water elements from around the world. And we were in Guatemala, we shot in Mexico. We did 70 dives in like 10 days. And I probably shot maybe 2,000 feet, maybe 3,000 feet of 35 on 70 dives. That's a lot of diving for not much footage. But animals don't cooperate. Like finding that perfect shot of animal is really hard. It requires patience, it requires anticipation. So you've really got to be aware of the environment, and a lot of the times you're in places where you're drift diving, where you've got current. So getting yourself positioned in the water in the right place ahead of time and really thinking about things ahead of time, that also takes practice. So anticipation to where you need to be. You've got to anticipate, where do I need to be in 1 minute now to get the shot of that giant black sea bass? That giant black sea bass is over here. I want to be over here. I want it to be dramatic. I'm now got to move myself into position based on the movement I'm seeing that animal. I mean, it can be even be the same with that that girl in the pink wetsuit that they're trying to sell you the trip to Jamaica with. You're not talking to her. She's not got an underwater communication system on. So again, watching their movement and anticipating where they're going to go and positioning yourself the right way takes forethought. You need to think about it, look ahead, think about where you need to land up. Okay, knowing your camera. Certainly if I'm using the Hydroflex Mark V, I've usually got a Preston Fizz system, iris focus zoom running to the surface. The camera system's looking at a monitor and is pulling focus for me. Basically, all I got to do is hang onto the camera. Same with the Alexa Mini housing. Most of the time, I'm just hanging on the camera. I know where sometimes I'll do my own run stop, but I'm hanging onto the camera. The other thing you've got to think about though is, what if I'm not connected to the surface and the assistant's not pulling the camera, pulling the focus? I need to know where all my controls are. And certainly if you go out and buy a A7S housing, there's a bunch of controls on these housings from the outside. You need to know where those controls are. I mean, I literally can sit at home. If I get a new housing that I haven't used before, I sit at home and I'm like, okay, where's... And I will find every control that I need by feel. I'll look, okay, it feels like that, feels like that. As silly as that... Jesus Christ. As silly as that sounds, okay, quick story. I was right before the pandemic shut down Los Angeles, I was teaching a private underwater cinematography class at this dive park, marine sanctuary in Catalina Island in California. Dive boat captain, who's an old friend of mine, came over and said, hey, there's a whale carcass about Little Farnsworth, which is a dive site about a mile away from this dive site where I was at. And he goes, there's white sharks, there's thresher sharks and blue sharks eating this carcass. I said, well, I'm teaching a class, but I'd love to come over. I'll come over later. Okay, great. Off he goes. I take my student down for a dive, and the first dive, there's a wreck that sits at about 80 feet. We've gone through a beautiful kelp forest. The next thing, I see a blue shark coming right at me, about 10 footer. I have no housing, I'm leading him. He's there to practice all that he's been taught, and he's behind me. And I see this blue shark. Now, blue sharks are a pelagic shark. They are in open ocean. You never see them in the environment that we are in. You never. You have to go in open ocean, deep water. To see this blue shark was like mind-blowing. I'm like, oh my God, he's got a camera. Oh, beautiful. And I look around and he's like, oh God, no. Okay, he didn't get it. Go back. I go back the other way, the second half of the dive. Now we're in about 50 feet of water. And next thing I see, again, blue shark goes the other way, heading back towards the whale, I assume. And I look, After that class, I added this page. Because people just... And, you know, honestly, I take responsibility. He said, well, I wanted to make sure it was turned on, and I couldn't figure out where the thing was. And I, like, we'd already practiced with this housing in the pool, but I realized that something he needed to learn, I need to add to the class, was the fact that you need to know where everything is, because these things can happen like that. And that was a moment that I've never seen in... I've been diving at that place for 30 years. I've never seen it before, never seen it since. So, housings. There are many types of houses. I'm not going to spend too much time on this, but there are a lot of housings. I say spend the money on a housing. Don't buy cheap housings. I know it's easy to say, but save your money. Invest. I like Nordicam housings especially. There's a housing, new housing in the US called Marlux, which are a little less expensive than Nordicam, but still very good housings. Actually, the company is actually owned by people that used to work for Nordicam. Now Nordicam has just released a housing for the Alexa 35. It's around $40,000, but it's pretty spectacular. It's designed to incorporate the Hi-Fi, follow focus system and so forth. It's pretty amazing, but it's a big investment. But you can certainly earn that back if you're doing enough work. This is the Hydroflex Mark V housing. This is a housing that I use a lot. This is the housings you saw in the early videos. This housing, as I said, is around 35 kilos out of the water. It has an 8-inch dome. As you notice, this dome on here, it's actually, it's got a real shallow curvature, which means it's a really big dome overall. Even though you're only seeing this much of it, it's a pretty big dome. So when you are setting your entrance pupil on a housing like this, be really conscious of the size of that dome. Hydroflex Mark V, Hydroflex deep water film housing. And then we have the hydropod with a hydro head. There are some shots. If you're chasing a swimmer, Olympic swimmer in a pool, and you've got to stick with him, good luck. You're not going to stick with him. So I would take a head like this, put it on a crane, put it on track, and now I've got full, I'm on the wheels, and now I've got full remote control under the water. I can check the swimmer, I can put grips on the crane, and they can run that crane as fast as we like. We can also bring that in and out of the water. Now, the trick with this, there's a crane by Chapman called a hydroscope, which is a technocrane-like crane that telescopes, but it has mercury for balancing in the arm. So what's great about that is you drop in the water, obviously, now this housing that's very negative now becomes neutrally buoyant or only slightly negative. The hydroscope moves the mercury through the arm and offsets that, so you have complete control coming in and out of the water. And you have a telescoping crane that telescopes to 30 feet. So it's pretty awesome. So you can do a lot of work in pools and tanks without ever having to get in the water. Smaller housing, Nordicam A7 housing, as I showed you here. Look at all the controls you have on here. There's some certainly white balance, key ISO changes and key controls, run, stop, iris, focus, zoom. You need to know what all these buttons do, and you need to do it by touch. Certainly, you don't need to control everything when you're ready to shoot. I mean, you're going to have a lot of settings set, but there's things you need to know where they are so you can react quickly and shoot. This is the Nordicam Alexa Mini housing, which I have one of these in Los Angeles. Great housing. It's got a full built-in weight trim system. It's really beautiful. It's kind of a mid-weight housing. It's not overly heavy, but it's got enough mass to be easily controlled. And you can run a WCU4 remote system for Iris Focus Zoom, and you can control all the camera settings from the surface. I like to shoot slow motion underwater, unless it's like action. If I really want to just capture beautiful underwater footage, I tend to like to shoot slow-mo. Unless, of course, you're shooting an action scene or a fight scene underwater, or somebody escaping from a car or something in a movie scene. I tend to like to shoot slow motion in the 40 to 60 frame area per second. Here's a red housing, same idea. Again, very similar to the Alexa Mini housing. You have remote control system for that. I'm not a big red shooter, so I can't tell you what remote systems they have for it, because I'm kind of an Alexa guy, so. This is actually my camera system. This is a BMP CC6K. I had this custom built for it because I wanted to be able to have a good trim system. This flotation on the top here is a little negatively buoyant, so that offset the negative buoyancy of the camera. A lot of the time, if you're going to buy your own housing, you're going to build it out as you feel fit for your own needs. I had this custom built. I've been working with this company called Ultralight Systems. I've now, since this was the prototype, I now have a trim weight system on this, and also have a system to support an outboard monitor, because sometimes if you're going to track beside something, rather than try and lay on your side and hold the camera like this, I actually built this system. Now I can put a monitor on it, I can turn it 90 degrees, and I can just grab the side of the camera and push it, and I'm looking this way or I'm looking this way, and then I can get full strength kicking to keep with what I'm tracking with on the side. It makes it a lot easier. Camera trim. This is actually a really important part of camera setup. Again, we were talking about earlier, we want to keep the camera level in the water. Now, some cameras want to do this, some cameras want to do this. Some cameras want to do this, they just want to sink. Some will want to float up, nose down. You have a large dome port. The dome port's got a lot of air in it and a lot of volume and wants to go bink. If you have to put energy in to force that camera down, or now you're putting energy into there that will make things move around. Low center of gravity. Now, some of you may put lights on the camera. Like, there's a lot of LED underwater lights now you put on the camera. Yes, you can offset the negative buoyancy of these lights with floats on the arms, but still where that mass sits, where it's fore and aft, will make a difference. You'll see a lot of still photographers with their strobes way up high, right? For a motion camera, all you're doing is making it unstable. Don't do that. You want everything low. Like, I set the light, if I'm using lights on a smaller housing, I'm not talking about the big cinema housings now, I'm talking about the smaller, like Sony A7 housings, keep them low. You don't need to be up here. Low center of gravity gives you more stability. Think of it like, I fly airplanes too, and a Cessna airplane we learned to fly on, high winged, fuselage sits underneath, aircraft is very stable to fly because of its a pendulum effect under the wing. Speaking of just a little adjustable trim weights, one way of dealing with the dome popping up, there's a bracket goes underneath, and puts a weight to bring that dome down and get it level. Also wheel balance weights. This is what you stick up, balance weights you'll buy at the auto parts store. You can stick these around the front edge of a dome, whether it's on the bottom edge or the top edge, to assist in bringing that down. The further out you get them, the better. And these weights are made to be, they stay on there for a long time. You know, they're made to go on the wheels of your car, you know, all sorts of weather, and they stay there. They do stick. Just a little more reference on CG, high center of gravity, low center of gravity. This is always going to be more stable. Keep the lights down. So either center of gravity is here. This gives you lift or positive buoyancy. The mass or the weight is below. So if you're creating lift, you want to keep the mass of the camera below. If it's the other way around, if you put the mass on top and flotation underneath, it's going to flip right over. Now, trim, Nauticam. Here's the Nauticam housing. This is the housing I have at home. You have quarter 20 points all the way along the rails of this housing. So you can add trim weights either side. You also have weight. This is a sliding plate underneath. Now you can add weights to here. You can move it fore, aft, wherever you need it to get it to sit level. Now sometimes on a housing like this, I've actually if I'm in a tank, not in the ocean, but when I'm in a tank, sometimes once I've added all this weight to it to get it level, now it's sitting level, but it's doing this. I don't want to have to lift that up because, again, that's the same problem. I actually got a little wheelbarrow tire, and on my dry suit inflator, which I'm not wearing, I just put a little attachment like you to pump up the car tires, and it's connected to my tank. And I'll just add a little air to that, put it in the center, and that will offset the negative buoyancy in a very simple way. And, you know, I'll just see the cable tied on there or tie it on with a piece of string, literally. It's that simple. Hydroflex Mark V housing, that has a different configuration. Underneath, you can mount trim weights. Same idea, fore, aft, get it balanced with trim weights. These panels on the side are actually lead. Now, you can put 16 different cameras in here, including an Alexa Mini. So if you put an Alexa Mini on here, now this thing comes really negatively buoyant. You can remove these lead plates, and you can put, it's like a cheese plate, just an aluminum cheese plate on the side. And then you can, then now we've brought the housing to somewhat neutral. The nice thing about the cheese plate on the side, for example, you've got a close-up of somebody's arm. You can actually mount a C-stand and like a watch, for example, like if you're selling a dive watch. You can actually have somebody rest their arm on there. You can find the distance and hold focus. So having the cheese plate on the side not only solves the buoyancy issue, it also becomes a good place to, you know, mount various things to help you with shooting. All right. So this I shot in Catalina Island. This sort of will tell you the value of I did this for fun for Blackmagic for a little test. This is a 4K pocket camera that costs like $1,200. Yeah, the housing was like $6,000, but the camera was $1,200. But it does show you how good even a very inexpensive camera can be shooting underwater. I mean, you can shoot, high-end footage with this. This is the dive park, by the way, where the blue shark came and went and nobody captured it. You know, California, it's cold water diving, so it's a lot of kelp forests, which can be incredibly beautiful. This is one of my students who actually did roll the camera when he was supposed to capture these guys. These guys are about 250, 300 kilos. They grow up to over two meters long. This guy had a head about this wide. They're really big animals. They were nearly extinct, and they made it illegal to fish them, and now it's a $100,000 fine if you capture one and they've come back. It's amazing. So not bad for a $1,300 camera, right? Not bad for a $1,300 camera. I mean, for example, I shot that camera. You know, it's a small investment, and you can shoot good underwater stuff that you can use in professional products projects with that camera. So don't necessarily underestimate those cameras, so you can do a lot with them. All right, underwater communications. What I like to do, because it's easier, and when I'm working with my grip team, my camera team underwater, electric team, I'd much rather use hand signals. You know, I can put my hand out in front, I can tell you I'm rolling, I can tell you I'm cut, I can do things like that. This is one-way communication. I can use a regular regulator in my mouth, or I can lay on the bottom on a hookah line, or, you know, not on a tang, just sit in a regulator in my mouth. Director, assistant director can talk to me. We can do a pre-arranged hand signal system, like, okay, for example, if I'm rolling, they'll tell me, okay, ready to roll, and I'll go, rolling, and beforehand I've said, once I've done that, I need 5 seconds to get set and you'll see the camera stable. And then the director will call action. You can, if you're doing music video work, you can play music through there. I've actually had bands actually sing underwater against green screens, then, or even not against green screens actually, but I've had them perform underwater, being fed music through an underwater speaker. Now, it just sort of turns out that it was not very clear. It kind of sounds very bright and loud and kind of like high-pitched, but it's enough for you to understand. Now, if this is not sufficient, I have these systems. It's OTS. It's a company called OTS. It's a full-face system. It has... this fits around the side here, and this is an ear, sits over your ear, so they can talk to you this way. This unit here would sit on your belt. It goes underwater. This is a great unit. This is a 25-watt unit you want to use in the ocean because it's got much more range. You can get a 5-watt unit, which you can use in a pool in an enclosed environment. It works great. It's a lot cheaper than the 25-watt unit. Here you have a microphone. It's a waterproof microphone that actually sits inside this the full-face mouthpiece here. This is a transducer. This drops in the water, and that transmitter talks to this transducer unit here, and then that cable unit goes back to this two-way communication system. So you can have a two-way communication system not only with the surface, but if you're working with grips and electricians, you have a complicated build and complicated setup underneath. You guys can communicate, talk backwards and forwards, and so on and so forth. I only use these when I really need to. If it's complicated enough where I need to have a lot of communication going on and communication to the surface two-way, then I'll use this system. I'd rather not. Number one, I don't want to have long conversations with the surface. I'd rather pop up and actually have a conversation. And because it is kind of tinny sounding, sometimes you've got to slow to speak. Okay, come on, I want to do this. I can't understand a word you're saying. You've got to slow down, and people need to speak slowly and clearly. So I do tend to not use that unless I really need to. Plus, I don't want a full face. I want to be able to spit my regulator and pop up and work more efficiently and quickly. You certainly see this stuff in like Discovery Channel when they're doing Shark Week. You'll see a lot of those guys with a full face on. They're talking to the surface. This is the system they use. You can record from it. They record, record the dialogue underwater. So there's definitely a place for it, but for me, it's not something that I would use every day. Okay. Simple hand signals. All right, I'm just going to wrap this up pretty quickly here because I want to allow you to ask me questions because that's fun for me. I love to hear what you have to say, but as we kind of touched on this, generally speaking, safety divers, really important. Why do we have safety divers? To keep people safe. We kind of talked about that. One safety diver per any actor, anytime you've got an actor in the water, one safety diver per actor. Electrical safety, we talked about that. GFIs, make sure you guys walk around and check all the electrical with your gaffer and make sure everything is on a GFI. Environmental risk factors, we're in the ocean. You need to think about current, what kind of support you have on the surface, what sort of depths you're at, what sort of water temperatures are. Don't forget, you've got talent in the ocean. If they're in the ocean, you want to make sure they have thermal protection. They will not last very long in cold water. So if the water is much below 98.7, you get in 85 degree water, they will get cold pretty quickly. So these are all things you've got to take in consideration. And as I said, whenever you're in the ocean, never get in the ocean if you haven't got a qualified marine coordinator. I won't do it. I'd rather walk away from the job. It's just not safe. Griffin Electric. Having a scuba certification does not make you an underwater grip, does not make you an underwater electrician. You've really got to have a good understanding of working underwater. I work with a couple of guys in LA, Steve Brumbaugh, and a guy called Soda Pop Franchot, who's kind of a legend underwater. I love working with him underwater. I don't have to listen to him complain, but he's absolutely amazing. He works with Pete Romano, Ian Takahashi, and a lot of those guys. Art department, wardrobe and makeup. Camera department. Water camera people, crucial. Art department, you drop a dirty set in the water, you're dead before you start. Having an art department that's worked in the water environment, knows how to build underwater sets is crucial. Any dirt, any muck on there will contaminate the water. And you do that, your shoot can be over and done with. Unless, of course, you're supposed to have garbage in the water, like you're using a tank that's supposed to be in a lake and you need dirty water, well, that's fine. But if you're looking for clear water, make sure your art department is aware and understands that, you know, you can't have any particulate in the water. Wardrobe and makeup, waterproof makeup, obviously. Wardrobe needs to be washed in fresh water. If your wardrobe department goes and washes the wardrobe in laundry detergent, it is going to contaminate the water. So something to stay on top of as well. And the last thing is working with your production team. I got an email two nights ago from a company that's never worked in the water, wants to know about what it takes to work in the water. I go an email. I have it's like a form email which I keep, which I talk about all the steps that it takes to work in the water. However long it takes on land, takes three times as long in the water. You got to have electrical safety, you got to have GFIs, you got to have underwater grips, you got to have underwater electricians, you got to have this many safety divers, you got to have this kind of support. So all of those things you want to discuss with production and put it down in writing, because it can come back and burn you. I've learned that the best thing you can do is to put everything down in writing, and when something that you've said doesn't occur or creates a problem, you can say, you can laugh, but it happens a lot. You would be surprised. People do not, a lot of productions do not want to deal with the realities of shooting underwater. They just want to work the same way they do on land. It does not work. Thank you. Thank you. Now I can see you all. It's so much nicer. Any questions? Yes.
Hi, thank you so much. This was really informative. I have a question. You touched upon dirt and pollution underwater. I would like to know how that does affect light. When you shoot in the ocean and you have murky water, and yeah. How does it affect the image? And also the second question would be, can you add filtration optically whenever you use these housings?
Sorry, what was the last one?
Can you add filters, optical filters in your housings? Diffusion, ND, blah, blah, blah.
You can add ND filters. The particulate, the more backlit it is, the more you're going to see it. It's kind of like smoke. The other thing is, when you're going to see this, if you put a light right over the top of the lens, you're going to get what we call backscatter. So all that particulate in the water, we're going to see. If you want to avoid seeing anything in the water, the best thing is tops off light or straight overhead. You're really up again. I mean, you really can only control so much. There's a still photographer that shoots in black limbo. He's up in San Francisco. Shoots all these models underwater and there's nothing. It's like there's no water at all. He's got thousands of dollars worth of filtration systems, and you have to scrub in the bath before you get in to make sure no skin comes. It's crazy. So you can only go as far as you can go, especially in movie work. Yes.
Yes, I had questions about lighting.
Lighting, yeah.
Especially with gels, if sometimes you gel the lights to match the light coming from above the water. I'm talking about lights that are underwater, and also about the housings of the lights with if there are tungsten, how the heat dissipates in the water.
Heat of the lights in the water, you mean?
The heat of the lights.
Yeah.
Yeah, the heat.
Let's look last part first. The underwater lights that I showed you here, you don't turn them on above water. They will burn them out. They are in aluminum housing, so that aluminum works like a heat sink and pushes it out into the water. So they still get hot, but the water does dissipate heat. Heat, you lose heat in something 25 times faster than air. So basically what the light is doing is trying to heat the entire swimming pool. It doesn't work. So, you know, heat's not a problem. Gels, yes, I use gels. Now, in the ocean, the deeper you go, now don't forget, if you're balanced at 5,600 Kelvin, now you go deep, maybe that's 25,000 degrees Kelvin because of the color loss in the water. So then you'll add blue light to the blue gel to the lights. Certainly in more of the tank situation, yes, I'll use regular gel. I use Opal, I use Tough Frost, I'll use 216, I'll use half CTB, full CTB, and whatever I need to make it work. Am I answering?
Thank you.
Thank you. Just regarding that question, can you tell if it's more efficient, like in a not so deep water, let's say, to if you want to add more red color, red part of the spectrum, yeah. Is it more efficient to use a filter on camera, as you mentioned, a red or magenta, or to use a red light or like warm light to support it?
Now, interesting point. Red light is actually different. I've actually used red light at night to shoot animals at night because they don't see red, so they'll actually not be affected by the light, but it's still going to look red. I've also had somebody put a red 26 black and white filter in front and then wonder why all the footage was red. There's a company called Magic Filter. They make underwater filters. It's okay to use those. If you know you're going to go deep, anything below anything deeper than 10, 12 meters, you can use these filters. Don't use them shallower. If you're in the tropical water, magenta, in cold water, like British Columbia or South Africa, then use the magenta. Okay?
Okay, thanks. My only experience is from scuba diving having a GoPro, so that's as far as I got.
Well, you know what's nice? Yeah, but you know what? They make a real nice kit for a GoPro of red filters. And red filters and magenta filters to drop on, they'll actually really helpful if you're using a GoPro. Mm-hmm. So take a look at that kit. It's good.
All right, thank you.
Yep. We got lots here going on.
Hi, thank you. It was very, very interesting. I have more an AC question about how do you work with your AC team? Do they have place, for example, to put other things like focus pooling system in the housing camera?
Yeah,
and
I've
for
actually
for a wireless to put the monitors. I guess the director has a monitor to communicate with you, or even your focus puller, so how do they work?
For example, for like the Hydroflex Mark V, let's stay in digital world for a moment, with the Hydroflex Mark V, we run a Preston system, so it's regular Preston motors, where it's Iris Focus Zoom, then that will go to the surface, and there's a video signal, video assist goes to the surface, the assistant is pulling off the monitor, and with Iris Focus Zoom, and the director's also viewing monitors up on the surface. And, we've communicated, we've made a plan. Alexa housings, we can run the mini housing, the Nauticam housing, we can run a WCU4, where he can do all camera controls from the surface and a video cable. Okay. Film cameras, either I'm going to pull focus myself through a viewfinder, which can be challenging at times, or we'll have an assistant come underwater and pull focus off a witness camera. They have a little witness monitor they put on the side, and they can pull focus off the witness camera. We can also send a video assist feed to the surface. But it gets a little challenging, you know, adjusting the level of the video assist. It's in a tank, it's a little easier because we can just drop it in, adjust it. Oh, it needs to close it up and stop. Okay, we've got it, it's consistent. When you're doing that in the ocean, it's not. So usually I'm like, no. I look through the viewfinder. I don't use the video assist very often.
Okay, thank you.
Yes.
Does any kind of autofocus works underwater?
I'm sorry?
Autofocus.
You know, look, what I've found is generally tracking autofocus is not, if you're using a smaller housing, certainly not a cinema housing, but you're, like I said, with the Canon R5C or, you know, A7S or Blackmagic cameras, getting that initial infinity focus with autofocus is great. The Canon R5C tracking system is actually really, really good. And you can use that. That tracking system really works well. You will find that things will come in and out. So I tend to work manually most of the time, but I will set that initial infinity focus. If my lens is, I'll aim the camera at something and hit the autofocus just to establish infinity, which actually holds a long way, like probably from 8 feet out to infinity, it'll hold. And when things come close, then I'll pull it. If I do use the colored line focus assist, certainly on the Blackmagic camera, or if I have a monitor on there that has focus assist, green works the best, believe it or not. And then I'll use actually the focus assist to manually pull focus. But you know, tracking autofocus can be good, it just varies. So it's not something I rely on, but I certainly use it as an assistant tool. Yes. Mike is coming to you. Hello.
Hello. So I have two questions for you. One is regarding the light, which you discussed like at depth, like when you go deep, you said you'll add CTB to make it more blue. So I quite didn't understand that. So
okay, you're talking about if you look at a lot of people's underwater footage and you see it all the time, whether it's a still photograph, when somebody's deep, you can see the subject looks either warm or slightly magenta, and then it's blue around it, right? What we're trying to do by adding a blue gel, as you go deeper, your color temperature is going through the roof. So what we're doing by adding, if you go on to underwater sites, you can actually buy blue gel covers for underwater LED lights. So the light is 5,600 Kelvin, 6,000 degrees Kelvin. Now we can bring them down to like 20,000 degrees Kelvin, which will make you more of an even color balance. So when you grade it, everything will match. I mean, it drives me nuts. And so now I've got to, when I see somebody's footage, I don't do it myself, when I see somebody's footage, now I've got to put a tracking power window just to deal with that area of color. And it can be a real pain in the butt. So think about that. You dive deeper down, you've got lights on the camera, add the blue filters. They come in a medium and a full. There's usually two levels. So carry both. I'd slip one on my belt. If I'm going deep, I'll switch it. And you can see it. When you turn the lights on, you can see it on the monitor. So, yeah, just be aware of that.
And just one more question is, when you do documentary video, like cinematography, how do you compensate for the current?
The current. Now, if I'm doing drift diving with current, then I'm going to let the current take me. If I've got a current coming, if I'm starting the dive, the current's coming this way, I'm going to start the dive going into the current. If I'm getting pushed sideways, then I'm going to swim 45 degrees to the current. It's really, it's more of a diving skill than a shooting skill, but it's really being aware of how the current's behaving. Certainly when you're diving in California, you've got the kelp forest. I literally was there 2 weeks ago and the kelp was laying flat on the bottom. So I knew I had to go into the kelp, not away from it, because now I've used half my air going out. Now I'm using way more air pushing against the current, and I'm going to run out of air and be in big trouble.
Thank you for your time. In terms of progression of it.
Oh, sorry. it's like lights in my eyes. I'm usually on the other side of these things.
It seems there's quite a high barrier to entry in terms of the cost of the kit. And in the UK, we have the HSE and things like that. So how would you suggest to progress through from the start to being an underwater cinematographer in terms of the hierarchy in the department? Is there like roles more junior beside you in the camera, or is it just a matter of, you know, finding the time to just start doing it?
What I found interesting, you know, when I started out, I started shooting film. I was in, you know, we all couldn't go and, you know, shoot underwater cameras because, you know, the cost of film and processing. So, you know, I had to rely on production to pay for that. So that took me a long time to break in, right? Nowadays, you will have the opportunity with these, you know, camera housings to actually go out and shoot stuff. And I always think the best thing you can do is buy an relatively, there's no inexpensive camera systems, but, you know, Alexa 35 housing at $40,000+ as opposed to, say, a 4K Blackmagic housing or an A7 housing, which you can get for $5,000. Now you have a system that you can actually go and shoot professional footage. You can go home with DaVinci Resolve and grade it, and you can build a reel. And that's what a lot of guys are doing. They're building reels. I have friends that have taken my class, they built reels, and now they're doing professional work. So that will pay for that gear pretty quickly. I mean, I rent my Blackmagic. My Blackmagic 6K housing is about $10,000 by the time you put everything together. You know, 10 days of work, it's paid for. You rent that for $1,000 a day on a shoot.
So, hello.
Hello.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I was just wondering, like, it's like a really small question. Do you know if there is anybody in Europe that is kind of giving lessons in underwater cinematography? Like, do you have some contacts? Because I'm not sure if I can always fly to LA, maybe.
Are you talking about classes?
Classes, yeah.
You know, I've actually, during the pandemic, this is sort of an abbreviated version of my overall class. My class is actually around 6 hours of classroom. During the pandemic, I actually set up my house with a green screen, multi-cam with a live switch, and actually was doing classes all over the world. So there will be a point, you can go to my website, which is vansburbury.com, and you can contact me through there. I do plan work global classes online via Zoom with a live multicam switch, you know, 2 or 3 times a year. I don't know anybody here, unfortunately.
Okay, thanks. Yep.
You mentioned you usually shoot at a 5.6 or an 8 f-stop.
Yeah.
But I couldn't understand what happened if you want to shoot at a wider aperture.
Well, I want a 5.6-8 is a tighter aperture, right?
Yeah.
So I'm going to just give me a second. I'm going to go back and I'm going to explain it a little bit. Okay, so look here. Yeah. Okay, you see the tighter aperture, right? This is, if that there was a really wide aperture, the light in the center is going to be much cleaner and sharper. As you get to the edges, it'll get soft. So the smaller aperture, the more, the further out the sharp plane of focus will stay. You want to keep it sharp to the edges, right? Now, if you have go wide open, it'll be much sharper in the center than it will the outside edges. It's purely a it's purely physics. It's a purely the smaller aperture cleans out the dirty light, if you like. Okay.
Hi.
Hi.
What are the challenges shooting anamorphic underwater?
Anamorphic underwater. Good question. Anamorphic underwater, close focus, a lot of anamorphic, 3 to 5 feet. Wide angle, 40 mil anamorphic, 3-5 feet. Okay. So what you got to do, get a tank or a pool, get a focus chart, get a set of diopters, get your lenses, test each one at various distances, and make sure you can get focus. That's really, it's simple. It's get them in the pool, because you're, don't forget, once again, here's the front of your dome port. Focus is going to be here. You can't focus that close, so you need to use diopters. Whether it's a plus one, plus two, plus three diopter, you need to use diopters. I just, DP Julio Macat just was doing an anamorphic film. He called me up for some advice, and what he landed up doing, just for the underwater sequence, he just went spherical, just because of the, you've got to have a prep day in and water, and you've got to have a underwater focus chart, and you've got to prep each lens for the, you know, otherwise you're going to have problems. Make sense? Yes.
Hi. Can you talk about lenses for the smaller housings? You mentioned the Blackmagic 4K. Are you shooting on cine lenses with that or on photo lenses?
That lens I used on there was actually it's a Micro Four Thirds lens. Nauticam make a gear system for it, and a gearing system for it, and a port for that. It's a Olympus Pro F28, and it's a great little lens. It's basically 7 to 14 millimeters, which in 35 millimeter turns is 14 to 28, which is a really nice range for wide angle underwater. Yes. Uh-oh.
Hi.
Yes.
Hi. I'm wondering about the Blackmagic 4K, like, because the batteries, they don't last very long. So how do you manage that?
Wonderful, if you give me a second, yep. I'm going to go to my full class for a moment, which is over here. This is my the class I actually use. And I am going to find the little video, and you'll see exactly how it all works. Here we go.
Also, just while you're looking for it, I'm just wondering what is GFI. Thank you.
GH5. Yeah. GH5 is only captures ProRes 422. What I like about this, I can shoot Blackmagic RAW, and I can shoot ProRes 444. But here. GH5? Oh, no, I honestly, I don't know that camera, so I can't answer you. Oh, GFI? You're talking about a GFI?
Yeah, you were talking about the cables with your gaffer.
Oh, right, yes. I'm sorry, I thought you were talking about power for the 4K.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
That was the previous question, the power for the...
Okay, well, let me just show you this, okay. And I can show you the... let me just show you. Here's how you power the 4K Pocket. 18650 batteries. Goes inside, plugs right into the side of the camera. And now you've got a... That's how you power that. It'll last... It'll give you about 3 hours of runtime with 3,500 milliamp hour batteries. The GFI question, what about it?
What does it stand for?
What's that?
What does it stand for, GFI?
Ground fault interrupter.
Okay, thank you.
So if you have a fault ground, like something gets wet, it's an interrupter, it just kills the power immediately. It's like a breaker. I don't know if you have them in your kitchen here, but we have in all the kitchens and bathrooms, we have an outlet with a little red button, little black button, and if it gets wet, it kills the power. Same idea, but big.
Okay.
Nice, thank you. Great tips. There was one question about the signals underwater and something like that. Like, what do you use? Is it wireless or is it like wired only for the director and for the set?
Communications?
Yeah, video communication. Because I had the experience that you lose a lot of signal underwater when you go deep.
Well, that depends on the power of the transmitter, okay? Like I'm using, like in ocean, I'm using a 25 watt transmitter. That gives me a lot of range. In a pool, I'm using a 5 watt. I before had 1.5 watt transmitter, and then I have problems. You need to use a powerful transmitter. OTS systems is the best system out there right now.
I was asking about a video playback system, like not audio communication.
Oh, video is just a hard cable to the server.
Hard cable, that's yep. It. No Teradex, no anything.
No Teradex. Okay. Hard cable. Yeah, you've got to be tethered. We use a 100 or 150 foot underwater sealed BNC cable. Goes to the surface. Do I have more? Any more?
I have a question. Could you speak a little further about choosing flat versus dome? When would you use either one?
Is it flat or dome port?
Yeah, is it okay. Purely optical or? Thank you. So
okay, much. A flat port. I'm going to go back to my little drawings because you know somewhere they're here. Yeah. Oh, here we go. Flat port. Flat port. Flat port. Flat port. Okay, if I'm looking at a flat port, if I use a wide angle lens in a flat port, this is what happens. It'll be sharp in the center because the light is becoming straight through that flat port. As you go further out, here's your entrance pupil, that light is bending and getting refracted. So what happens is not only does the image distort as I reference in these straight lines, but also all these outside edges are soft. So long lens telephoto is only gonna look through the center part of the lens, right? Sorry, the center part of the port. So great, that works. With a dome port, if you see, it doesn't refract. This is what happens with a flat port. There's the port, and the further out you go, the more refracted the light is. With the dome port, it doesn't refract, right? It's all the lines stay straight. The light comes in straight and does not refract. Therefore, you get an even lit field for anything wide-angle lens. That makes sense?
Well, you mentioned that if you're doing like a split surface shoot, then you might want to consider one kind versus another kind of.
Sorry, what? Shooting on the split surface?
You mentioned like if you're split surface above and below water at the same time, you might do one kind of port versus another.
There's sort of conflicting about that, but I always tend to use a dome port. If I can shoot at 11 or a 16, I will. That way I hold underwater and above. And then you've just got to decide which do you want tack sharp? Is it the underwater or the surface? But if you use something really wide, like a 14, get a 14 close to the subject, then and shoot like an 11 or a 16, you're going to pretty much hold both above and below. Make sense? Flat port, I just don't do it. I just don't like it. I don't like the aesthetic. I mean, maybe there's a moment you could use it, but I don't like the aesthetic. I'd much rather use a dome port. It's a lot more effective. I just get a bigger dome. I also use the biggest dome I can use as what I can find as well, which helps. Anybody else? Yes. Mike's coming your way.
So, is there any advantage to using the flat port? Like, why are they made? Are they cheaper?
No, flat port. The primary use of flat port is shooting macro.
Okay.
Right. So now we've got 25% magnification. The Most still photographers use it for macro. I use them for macro. If I am in really in a tank, and I got really clear, like I've had stars underwater, and they're women and they want beauty. I may if I've got very clear water, and I'm shooting something in here, maybe I'd go to a flat port with maybe a 65 millimeter lens. So now I've got this beautiful long lens. Without any distortion. Usually though, I'll use something like a 35 under a dome port and just bring it closer. But it's one of those things that maybe I do, maybe I don't. I mean, I can use a longer lens in a dome port, right? And now I just drop diopters in. Sometimes I'll do that rather than pull the dome port out, bring in a flat port, I'll drop a longer lens on, leave the dome port on, and then I'll drop maybe a +2 or +3 diopter in there, and that solved that problem.
Thank you.
Okay, yes.
Besides the obvious certifications, what advice would you give for picking up like underwater G&E jobs? Because I'm scuba certified, but haven't done any of like underwater grip jobs, but am interested in picking some.
Hone your diving skills, and if you can work on if you can get on a job, I do. I mean, I know when I was starting out, I'd go want to learn even about DP work. I'd go and do a job for free. Just to learn. And it doesn't take long, but you do need to understand how to work underwater. For example, you're gonna set a C-stand underwater. Now it's pretty floaty, right? What are you gonna put on it to stop it floating away? Or are you gonna put a regular sandbag on it? No. You need to order an underwater shot bag. An underwater shot bag is stainless steel shot. Otherwise, if you put lead, or sand, obviously, you're gonna mess up the water. It's things like that. Grips do work underwater very much the same way they do on land. They set flags, they set C-stands, but we're using underwater flags, we're using underwater rags, underwater green screens, and it's hard work. So, and you need to be coordinated, and you need to know how to work with each other using hand signals and things like that. So if you can find grips that are working underwater, just say, hey, I want to help, and go and help. I mean, that's really the best way to learn. Learn by doing. Yes?
Hello. Fantastic presentation. I have two questions.
Yes.
One, do you put camera on the scooter, of course, underwater?
Yes, we actually have a camera mount. I don't use the big Hydroflex housing on a scooter, but I have a mount. We have a mount with a quick release plate that I'll use, say, the Blackmagic 6K on, because it's small and compact, and it's rig neutrally buoyant, so the scooter works really well. And if you want to do stuff driving through a canyon, flying through a canyon and things like that, the scooter works great. I have some friends who do a lot of technical cave diving. They do that. They rig a camera on a scooter and go flying through the caves. It's actually really cool. Yeah.
The second, do you use dome port glass on or acrylic?
Only always glass.
Always glass.
Always glass. I mean, if you damage a glass port, you have to replace the glass, and it's expensive. They're more expensive. You damage an acrylic port, yes, you can buff it and repair it, but I find it a little optically not perfect. So all the professional housings are glass.
So
it's more expensive, but invest the extra in a glass port. Just be careful with it, that's all.
Okay, thank you.
Anybody else?
Hello there.
Hello.
I just wanted to ask, is there a thing like underwater camera drones used in film work? Because I know they're used for observation.
Underwater what?
camera drones?
Yes, there are. Actually, there's, and I was literally just, there's the Firefish, I think, out of China, and there's a few underwater drones. They shoot like regular sort of 4K MP4s. I just literally saw this 2 days ago. There's a new underwater drone that you can put, you know, full-blown cinema cameras in now to shoot underwater. That takes all the fun out of it. I want to go. The wonderful thing is I get to go diving in really cool places. I don't want to have to sit on the boat and go, yeah. But yes, they are there. And you're just ruining all my, you know, it's like I love flying, hanging out of a helicopter or using a space cam and flying in a helicopter and controlling the camera. Now drones have ruined that for me. Yes.
Hi, a quick question. What is the maximum depth you can go to film without before losing light?
You know, depends on the environmental conditions, but I regularly, for just wildlife stuff, not necessarily not film work, because I won't do film work too deep because it's too dangerous, but for wildlife, I'm 80, 90 feet. I've shot with no lights. I prefer not to use lights if I can help it. I'd rather do either put filtration if I'm shooting film or grade it on the back end rather than use lights. If I have to use lights, I'd rather have divers with LED lights, like a cluster, and I actually will position them underwater like hovering light stands. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yes.
Short question on electricity. I heard about transformers that are doing isolation. Have you heard about this? Is it more useful than GFI?
About GFIs, yes. I got to, okay. I can't quite hear. Sorry.
I heard about transformers who do isolation.
Transformers that do isolation?
Is this useful or do you just use GFI?
Use GFI.
Okay.
Honestly, don't mess around. The GFIs will literally, the instant there's a ground fault, they will shut everything down. And that's what you want. Okay. You don't want to, not worth taking the risk. Use GFIs. Right. I mean, they're pretty common. I mean, even in sets with rain, now power's run by GFIs. So big poor GFI in distro. Yeah.
Hi. I have a question about flaring.
Flaring?
Like the flaring of lenses, is it like a huge difference?
No, I mean, I do things where I look up at the sun. What you've got to be really careful of is sometimes, if you're in the ocean especially, you can get little beads of muck stuck on the lens. And because focus is just in front, you hit that, you can actually see it all. So it's really important to like, I continually wipe the front of it, just not rubbing the lens, just wipe in front of it to clear that stuff off. Now, if you've got any sort of chip in the lens, you'll have problems with the flare. But no, it's very similar. A little more scattered because, you know, water is already scattering the light, but it is very similar.
Okay. Also with flat and dome, also no difference between flat and dome?
No, I mean, not really. I mean, it's probably a little different. Flat port, if you're on a long lens, it may flare a little more naturally. But yeah, I find that it's the only thing you, oh, sorry, there's a good point. If you're flaring, you're looking up into the sun. If you have a lens that has lettering around the inside, like on the front of the lens, it has letters, you know, like F2, you know, 20 millimeter F2.8, black that out.
Oh, yeah.
Because guess what? The sun hits that, it lights up the front of the lens and you see it reflected in the dome.
Yes, good point.
Anybody else? Well, thank you all. Oh, one more up the back. One more. I see him. One more victim, and then you can all go home. I'm sorry.
Sorry, guys. Coming from Europe, what places, what courses would you recommend? Would you recommend the PADI video geography course?
PADI's videography course is a pretty good place to start. Take the PADI videography course and take the PADI peak buoyancy course. Those are the videography. It's a really good introduction, and that course is pretty good. I mean, it's an amateur course, but it's a good, opens the door really well. And then the peak buoyancy course is really important as well.
So the classes you do in the US,
is there anything
like the classes you do professionally in the US that you can find in Europe?
As far as I know, not. I wrote the course. I'm the only one authorized by NAWI to teach it. I've spent 6 years developing it. It's developed over 6 years, and now it's very focused professionally. I do it online. You can go to my website, and we can talk, and we could set up a classroom, at least for all the science and classroom stuff we can do online. It's about 6 hours.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome. Thank you, everybody. Thank you for coming.